Dear friends and colleagues, it is my pleasure to introduce today's speaker, Minesh Parikh. Minesh Parikh completed his B.Arch and Master's in Landscape Architecture from SPA Delhi. In 1994, Minesh co-founded NMP Design with Nandita Parikh. NMP Design is a multidisciplinary practice based out of New Delhi and is consulting on landscape and urban planning projects across the country and abroad. NMP Design is known for exemplary design quality and extremely high level of professionalism. Nandita and Minesh have been teaching at the Department of Landscape in SPA since the year 2000. Minesh has served as the chairperson of ISOLA Delhi chapter for two terms from 2012 to 2016. Minesh is a senior consultant to the Delhi Urban Arts Commission for city level studies. His recent contributions include proposals for redevelopment of Connaught Place, redevelopment of Bowli, redevelopment of Ignor Road, and redevelopment of Chanakyapuri Greens, among others. Minesh is also a fellow member of both ISOLA and IIA. In 1991, liberalization brought on by Narasimha Rao and Manmohan Singh saw India leapfrog from the mindset of a non-aligned movement member to a global player in the world arena. Liberalization made travel easier for everyone. Easier travel and media revolution made it possible for Indian populace to experience the built environment of developed countries. Liberalization also made it possible for foreign landscape firms to engage in professional work in India. It looked like the landscape discourse will be dominated by these foreign landscape firms for several years to come. Foreign firms had experience of having handled more complex and sophisticated projects. They had better knowledge and accessibility to advanced software. Indian firms were still trying to deal with computerization. The emergence and rise to prominence of NMP Design as a premium landscape design firm in the country coincided with this period. As said by author Janet Fitch, memory is the fourth dimension of any landscape. Good urban landscapes create everlasting memories and identity to a society and its culture. With projects spanning over three decades, Nandita and Minesh have introduced a rare beauty and added a unique value to our world. These intricately crafted and detailed spaces, many of which you will see today, and many of which are the resultant of collaboration with renowned architects and artists, have become the standard of excellence in design. Minesh's dedication to the expansion of the profession of landscape architecture is especially enduring, and I might add endearing. With the force of his personality and the strength of his vision and his unswerving commitment to the profession of landscape architecture, Minesh has inspired, challenged, and mentored generations of landscape architects all over India, and now here he is. It's with significant pride and a great deal of honor that I introduce landscape architect Minesh Parikh.
Okay, I have great pleasure and very good memories of this college where I spent 7 years studying, and I see some of my classmates and seniors are here today. So I wish to thank all of you for having made it to this talk in the middle of the week and in the middle of the day. Thank you very much. I think I'll begin now. So when we were in college, the most talked about project in landscape was a project which was called the Asian Games Village. And this was really a landmark achievement in those days. The architect was Professor Mohammed architect was Raj Rewal, and the landscape was done by Professor Shaheer. And they were both, you know, professionals in their prime in those days. And this was more or less what the layout of Asian Games Village looked like. And what you can see here is that it's a series of courtyards. One courtyard is a green, the next one is a parking, the next one is a green, the next one is a parking. So it was alternately greens and parking. And then there was a large central open space which was connected from one end to the other, so you could just walk it from here to there. This landscape of that era or that time looked more or less like this, as you see here in the photograph. So basically, we were talking about a multi-purpose space, which was an open space with lawn in it and some planting. And it was used by different people of the society at different times of the day. Next. Another project of that time was the one which is known as Tara Apartments. And the architect was Charles Correa. The landscape was done by Professor Ravindra Bhan. And this is what the images of Tara Apartment look like, you know. This was the play area in Tara Apartments. Now, the profession underwent a major change around 1990. And what caused the change and how it happened, that is what we will look at first. As Vinita mentioned just before, Narasimha Rao and Manmohan Singh together brought about liberalization, which caused the travel restrictions to go, making travel very easy. Indian population started traveling abroad. And foreign professionals started traveling to India and getting professional work here. The other change that happened was a change in the demographics of our society. 15 years of good medical science resulted in the elderly population of our society rising from 6% to 21%. This happened over 15 years. So we had, you know, many more elderly in our society now. There were several other things that happened around that time. All the cities of India saw a change in FAR and densities. So Asian Games Village was built on an FAR of 0.75. And the highest FAR that is now allowed in our country is 4.0, which is in along metro corridors of Ahmedabad. Along the metro corridors of Delhi or NCR is allowed an FAR of 3.0. So regulation allowed four times more FAR, and everyone wanted to make use of it, which meant that if you had an open space measuring 100 meters by 100 meters, it will be used by four times more number of people, which was a remarkable change, because the picture of Asian Games Village which you saw, you see the greens are very quiet. And now the greens, because of four times more population, are swarming with people. Next. So all these factors together, they changed the aspirations of the people, what they expected of the landscape. And we are going to study or see what changed. What changed in terms of aspirations? So we'll go over it one by one. So this is a summary of what people wanted now, what they never wanted earlier. So we will go through it one by one. Intense landscapes, because the population using the open space multiplied four times, people wanted much more out of that space. People wanted well-designed children play areas. They wanted spaces for organized games. They wanted spaces for exercise. They wanted greens which can be used for contemplation. And all these spaces have to be adorned or decorated with art installations. These were the basic minimum aspirations people had. We'll look at these things one by one. And every time you see an image on the screen, try to compare it with the Asian Games Village and the Tara apartment image to realize what is the difference in the scale, intensity of design, and as well as the number of users there. So these are some of the design play areas. And design children play areas are not only the play equipment, but you will see some, you know, built up mounds and so many other things, you know, steps and ramps and walls that children can jump over. Then in Western economy or in Western hemisphere, sports complexes are the norm, but our country is so starved of sports facilities that not by choice but by default, and it is only in India that it happens, that you know, housing or residential complexes need to have organized spaces for games. And these are images from projects done by our office, and you can see that not only are these spaces used very intensely during the day, but they are also used late into the evening hours. Though a little recent, but another trend is of outdoor exercise, where the weight of the person who is exercising is used as, you know, for exercising. Instead of lifting weights like this, your own body weight is converted into that weight. And spaces for contemplation. So this again is, you know, aspirations of the people to have spaces which are intellectually stimulating and also, you know, allow you some solitude. So these are seating spaces which are in the garden, overlooking the lawns. And sometimes urban spaces just need a small forest where the light can filter through. Lot of seating opportunities and walking trails, because walking and exercising is what everyone aspires to do in landscapes. Seating opportunities which are aesthetically pleasing, and art installations in many forms, sculptures, wall murals. The drainage technology underwent a drastic revolution and, you know, changed totally. Part of it was driven by the need to do what is called a basement parking with a garden on top. And we have used a variety of advanced drainage techniques. What you see on the right is a slit drain, for example, in a project called Cascades. And what you see on the left is a project called Habitat, and you see these red circles. They are the inconspicuous drainage points in the landscape, which are made possible due to this advanced construction systems. Now, in the picture on the left, you can see a slit drain which is barely 1 centimeter wide. This project is the Laburnum. It was delivered in 1997, good 20 years back. And this system is still operational and works very well. On the right, what you see are basically, on the top is another way of doing a slit drain. On the bottom is just a method of hiding the services. What you see on the left is a fixture, which is a common fixture which deals with surface and subsurface drainage. As you can see in the section there, the grating you see at the top, which is aesthetically very pleasing and does away with the masonry work around it, it goes down up to the slab, and the collar is where the subsurface drainage water is collected. and it is transmitted from under the slab. This is a very neat system, very efficient, fast, a little advanced in terms of engineering required to do it, but makes life much easier. Now, what you see on the left top is the surface expression of this drainage system and nothing else. It's just 9 inches. What do you see? Go back. What you see on the right hand side, those circles, that is how this fixture looks like when you see from a distance. And on the left, the image at the bottom, it shows how the drainage happens under the slab from this fixture as per the section showed earlier. So it's a technology, very integrated technology, very easy, fast, and safe. And it totally does away with perforated pipes laid to slope on a lean concrete bed. None of that is required. The material selection part itself became worthy of a thesis or a research topic, and we'll just show you what we have undergone in terms of material in our search and quest for materials. What you see here are samples of stone workmanship, mostly done using solid stones. And solid stones, you know, working with them is almost like crafting. Each section has to be detailed out. Each section is changing. Each joint is drawn out before it goes to site. And the end result is a thing of joy, you know. Now what you see on the left is again a 450 high planter wall, which is crafted with solid stone blocks of 6 inches high each. And then it's a water body. And what you see on the right bottom is an amazing material which we researched and developed along with a specialist agency. It's a precast concrete coping with terrazzo finish, like the old fashioned terrazzo which used to be done in old houses. It's a monolithic finish without any joints, and the, you know, it resembles red granite, but basically it can resemble any sample that is given to the, you know, craftsmen to replicate. So it can represent any granite or any marble by adding pigments and by adding aggregate. And we have done a lot of such crafting work with stone, and this is Hassan green granite in circular rings and conical shape. So as you go up, the length of each piece of granite reduces by a few millimeters. And it is crafted so beautifully with a slit for a light between each piece. So between every two piece, there is a 1 inch gap for a light, an LED light inside. What you see on the right hand side is a precast concrete coping with terrazzo finish, which has been, you take a circle and you divide it into 8 equal parts. Each part is identical. You fabricate the grating coping in factory, ship it to site and fix it, assemble it. No cutting, no chamfering, nothing. It's just runs through. What you see on the left, now we did a project where we developed only one section of precast concrete. The same section was used in the picture above as a coping. It was laid flat, horizontal. In the picture below, the same section is used vertically to do a step planter. Now, the beauty about exposed concrete is that it looks very elegant in contrast to the greenery around it. It has a hardness which is more than any other material. most of this material is M45 grade. It's almost sculptural in the way it has been used. The best thing is that precast concrete does not chip off. It does not deteriorate with time. It does not weather as 18 mm stone does. And it requires some amount of effort to draw each of these things out nicely. But if you see each and every planter, even the joints are predetermined. They are aligned and all the angles and the length of this precast member keeps reducing as you go up on the corner. So with some detailing, it is possible to do a thing which is long lasting and durable and very green because of the additional fill that you get on the slab. These are some of our other experiments with materials. So, the cost considerations make it important to work with a material which is called broom finished concrete, which is much cheaper than having to use a stone cladding. And then it just looks beautiful because of the way the joints are worked out. And these leaves are impressed on the concrete. Next. Now this is again a way of crafting with the stone. As you can see, the tread keeps changing as the function keeps changing. So where it's the planter, the tread is really just 75 or so. When it becomes a step, it becomes 450 or 300, and then sometimes it becomes an amphitheater, then it becomes 1200. And all this workmanship is with solid stone. Each piece of the stone is drawn out in elevation and plan. Now on the right hand side top is again an example of just a mere function of, is the corner of an amphitheater. The mere function of grade change can become a sculptural expression in landscape, as you can see here. What you can see on the left is the same thing in a water body. Next. Yeah. Lighting almost was a revolution because lighting was not even considered a design discipline when I was in college. And even now, we don't have any lighting design courses anywhere in India. But what the lighting can do is magic. This is a hotel project in Jaipur, Lee Meridian, Jaipur. And this is a public park in Ahmedabad. And the point to be noted is that people expect this level of design intensity, lighting design intensity and landscape design intensity in a public park. And that's what the new projects are all about. This more or less demonstrates the lighting, but also demonstrates what water can do to any space. It can animate, it can make magical experiences as you traverse it. Some more examples of lighting. Sensitivity was always an important part because the new order was with a fixed cost because there was a delivery price and you have to stay within the price. We devised some very innovative ways of dealing with cost. What you see on the top right hand side is basically a paving pattern which is used, which uses crazy pattern of the Jaisalmer stone which is rejected from the apartments. So it's a waste material which is used in a crazy pattern. and some borders just give it a design feel. What you see on the bottom is an exposed concrete walkway, but with a stone border. And what you see on the top left is just basically exposed concrete with broom finish. Universal access is another concept which became very important because the elderly population really rose in numbers and it became a critical thing to provide comfort to the elderly. Well, horticulture was a total change because whenever a landscape architect's services are engaged, the laymen, they think that the landscape architect will provide exquisite quality of horticulture. That's the minimum expectation. And how horticulture changed, next slide. This is the level of intense greenery in short period of time that today everyone aspires to have. Some color and some fragrances and some light and shade patterns. Now this is a project where you have walking trails with bamboo, you know, overlapping from both the sides. And the lay people are now aware and sensitive to varieties of plants and how you use them and what are the planting effects that you provide. Next. This was a hill project and its minimum requirement was to achieve a certain level of afforestation in the barren hill. It took about 7 years to accomplish this, which was barren rock. And all the walls are with ivy and whatever, hill plants. Now, intellectually stimulating layouts is because majority of work which is going on around us is basically a site plan with the building footprint. You leave the fire tender out and do some little bit here, there, and that's it. We were able to work with some of the projects where the landscape design was the driving force, or it was the leading element in the perception that people have of the complex. And this was able, we were able to achieve this with the help of these layouts. And as much as they are stylish, they are very, very functional, utilitarian as you go. And yet they stimulate your mind to think of what is there and what is not there, and to use your imagination. And many of these were inspirations from either nature or from some form of other. Like this, what you see on the left is a water body in Nahargarh Fort near Jaipur. And you know, the resultant landscape is, you know, carrying that language further. And this is how it is as it gets built on site in reality. And this was a layout which was mostly inspired by the shifting tectonic plates in an earthquake zone, more like this site being in Sona, that's quite prone to these kind of changes in the geology. And see how it develops into a design as we go along. What you see here are those shifting plates, and then next. So your walkways are accordingly altered to, you know, carry the idea forward. Next. And landscapes now engage much more with the people around, living around them than they used to earlier. As designing of waterscape is something which, again, by default has ended up in the laps of the landscape architects. In countries abroad or developed economies, you have separate people, separate consultants who do waterscape. You know, there are firms like wet design and, you know, fluidity, who only design aquascape for you. But we are in an economy where these specialized firms are not there. So as a default, we end up doing aquascape, and it has to bring that thrill into the landscape with the lighting and the water and the sound of water and the foliage. That if we want to make our landscape successful, then we have to deal with the aquascape part. Now, for example, this, it's a setting, you see, though it's pattern making, it's mostly visual, but with the dense populace that lives around the courtyard and looks at this setting every day, it's a magical setting. It's a delight to stay in a place offering such views. So this brings us to landscapes which delight and which cater to multiple aspirations, which cater to multiple constraints, multiple choices. These are landscapes of pluralism, and this is now the order of the day for all of us to deal with. And it's not a new concept, because ancient Indian texts talk about a concept called Satyam Shivam Sundaram, which talks about one idea or one individual which embodies all the three values. And different people assign it to different headings. You can associate it with an individual or a lord or a God, or you can associate it with any great phenomenon in nature or any great product that has been built or designed. It will stand true to these values. It's beautiful because it's Sundaram, it's truthful, and it's Shivam is destructive. So that is the mystery part. What does Shivam do? And pluralism is the doctrine of multiplicity. And it is not just problem solving, it is affirmative action or positive design to lead to a final product which satisfies all the constraints. The key words being, it is not mere problem solving, it's much beyond, it's positive design. And the new world order is that, you see, we grew up, we studied in colleges, and the iconic names then were, you know, Professor Raj Rewal, Charles Correia. But the new world order, the projects are so large, teams are so big, no person can claim total ownership of the final product. It's a teamwork, it's driven by teamwork. And, you know, that's what the pluralism is about in the teamwork. The important part nahi hai next. Next pe jao. I will run through some of the layouts for you. And This is a project, Rangoli Gardens in Jaipur, and you know, it embodies all the various values that we spoke about, you know, horticulture, lighting, games, children play, engagement with people. And I'll kind of run through the images of what it looks like. Some of these images you've seen earlier, but and these are, although these are middle class housing with, you know, ticket size of 40 lakhs or so, and the aspirations are, you know, 3 swimming pools, everyone wants to swim, pool deck, clubhouse, separate pool for kids. Now this is on the terrace garden. The terrace landscape is a new aspiration, you know, because when the FAR was low and the space was available in abundance and people had all the space they needed, now the densities are so high and the space is at such premium that more and more people are coming to us with the desire to do terrace landscapes. And what you see here is an expansion joint dividing the synthetic turf into two parts. Children play, the trees which are located on columns, and what you see on the right hand side is a skating rink on the rooftop. The surfaces you see on both the sides of the green are basically skylights which are covered. And this is a new language of what's happening around us. This is another layout, and when we were doing this layout, we see a lot of layouts in the course of our work and travel and interaction with people. And we wanted to do a layout which, when you see the layout, it leads by the design component of the layout. It's not just leaving fire tender and, you know, planting the rest. So what you see here is on the left corner top is our tennis courts, then under that is an amphitheater, which is a skewed amphitheater, and then there are lawns. On the right of the lawns is a water body. On the right of the water body is a club building with the swimming pool. And then there are spaces for contemplation. There are some more play courts in this. Next. And how it converts into a real built project and what it looks like with the planting and how the lines look on the ground and how mundane and monotonous can the architecture be and how the landscape brings cheer and joy and softness and fun to the whole layout that you will see in these photographs. Such spaces, and this particularly was a water body which was mostly inspired by the famous Granada fountain. And so this is the view you get from your balcony in the evening hours, and this is what is truly magic. And our cities where the view is really not pleasing, in a controlled environment we are able to create views which make you feel good and amenities which middle class of our country yearns for. Interspersed with art. This was one of the earliest projects we did as a firm, and this was a 25 acre hotel project in Jaipur. And The arrival space was not under a porch, but it was a drop-off, which was 100 meters away from the porch, and you walk 100 meters to enter the hotel. Now that itself was quite a difficult one to work with the owners, but you walk through a very nice garden, which is based on the choppered, and you enter the hotel, and then there is a poolside. Next. So this is what more or less it looks like to enter the place. And the greenery and the water interspersed with each other. This is the poolside. Night views. So if you will notice, we were able to build a trellis around the trees. So the trees go up through the trellis, and then the whole thing is covered with climbers. The nice, this is the Indian restaurant where they serve the food with the music, and then it's overlooking the swimming pool. You see here the Yeah, next. These are evening shots. This is a project, and you know, when the land was acquired, and if you notice how crooked the land is, and it was very difficult to even do a site plan which would make sense, because it was these very odd shaped, odd sized offsets all over. And the entry is also, you know, at one corner, and they don't connect well and whatnot. So we decided to go with a free-flowing layout. With another interesting thing here is the central green does not have a basement under it. So the basement parking is only under the towers. And those towers, the basement parking under the towers, the landscape is sunk by one floor. So from the basement parking, the landscape is at grade, allowing natural light and ventilation. And if you see the pictures, that next, this is a rendering showing how the built mass is distributed, and the valley area is on natural virgin ground. And the podium, what you see, has parking under it. Next. So this is the finished thing, and the same values, steps, sculptural materials, the design stimulates the minds, is a composition in its own right. Next. Now this as a composition is how the landscape blends with the club and the club roof. The roof is also a landscape, and you know, each one, the whole thing is a composition which blends with each other. And the language is carried more or less through the entire project. The horticulture is tropical, you know, is a mixed planting of variety of plants. What you see on the left is the basement parking at grade with the valley. Those columns have parking areas behind them. Next. And this is the level of horticulture now in housing complexes. Next. So this is the amphitheater, but more or less in the same language as the rest. This is a project we did in the hills. It's the Jayaprakash University of Information Technology near Solan, Vaknaghat. And the challenge was, a mix of afforestation, horticulture, design spaces as are required in a university campus, and how to deal with the grades. Next. And we were able to do a fairly nice finished product, of a very dense architecture, softened solely by the landscape. And these are really ground plus 8 buildings in a hill situation. This was barren rock, which was converted into a forested hill. Next. So these are student areas, which amphitheater and sit-out areas, canteen for students. And then these are lawn areas and contemplation spaces and play areas on different levels of the hill. Next. Okay, I think I'll end it by, it's a proverb which says, it takes a village to raise a child. And what I've realized is that it takes a village to build one project like this. And so many people, contribute, and then the final product is successful only if each one, performs their task up to the right standards. And that is what the new world order is in our profession. I would like to, next, thank my colleagues and team members, Nandita, Rohit, and Paris. I'll just ask them to walk over, please. Thank you, everybody. She's Nandita, most of you know her, and this is Paris. Paris and Rohit are part of the team that has built all these projects. Thank you, everybody. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now I would request Mr. Anil Dewan to please give the vote of thanks.
So thank you all for coming. It's a week when we have the fire training happening in the other building, and we have the next program, which is the Indian Plumbing Council coming and talking about skills development program on plumbing. So I'd like to thank Manish, his office, and all the landscape architects, our students, faculty who are here today, for making this a grand success. We have people who are standing and the air conditioning not well. This is typical SPA, this is what it is. And so maybe you come out and join us for some water at least. And then thank you again, thank you all. Thank you very much.